Hello, Be Well Buzz family. Thank you for joining us today. Today we're going to be talking about a very important topic. Oksana and I have Joy Houston, who you may have seen on television. She's an inspired raw food chef and nutritionist. And we're going to be talking about a really important topic, and that is succeeding with diet. We're all looking to feel good, to feel better than we ever have. And in that quest to feel the best we ever have, there's always little stumbling blocks and things in our path. So we're going to talk about ways to avoid those stumbling blocks and get to that inevitable goal of succeeding through eating the right foods. So let's get into it. We're going to first start with relationships with food and why people struggle in attaining that goal of whether it be weight loss, achieving success with maybe it could be a goal of exerting fitness goals,
get rid of disease,
whatever it may be.
Or just simply feeling better.
Exactly, exactly. So my goal ultimately is that we remove those barriers, not just until you get to the goal, so not until you lose the weight or you solve the health problem, but ultimately what I aspire to do is to help people remove those barriers for life, so that instead of being on a diet, they're actually on a new life path. They're on a different sort of way of living and eating and exercising that they enjoy so much. They've removed the barriers so much that it actually just becomes a natural, enjoyable way of life. Mm-hmm. So there's three barriers, I think, to doing that. And you've covered the first one, and that's your relationship to food.
Right.
And then there's two others that I think we should cover if we have time today too, which is social eating.
Yes.
And then willpower.
Yes.
So willpower shows up for us sometimes, doesn't show up for us sometimes. So I think those are the big ones.
Absolutely.
If we can get those under control and have strategies in place to deal with those, you're golden.
We're good.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
And you're good for life.
Yeah.
So the first one that you brought up is relationship to food. Now, your relationship to food is something that you personally have to examine. This is something nobody else can do for you. Mm. So what I like to do to get people over their hurdle of dealing with their relationship to food is to just take a few days, maybe even just one day, but a few days is good so that you have different stressors, different things happening in your life, and notice when you eat. Mm-hmm. Now, that might sound really funny because you think, well, I eat at breakfast, and I eat at dinner, and I eat at lunch, and so on and so forth. But me, for example, I notice if I finish a proposal for a client or I finish something big and I'm really happy with myself, I'll be like, oh, let's have a snack. You know, like, let's, I celebrate with food. So the first time I did that exercise for myself, I noticed that it was my sort of way to pat myself on the back and say, good job, Joy. Let's go rock out with some kind of snack. So that was my sample of my relationship for food. I wasn't really a nervous eater. I didn't eat when I was sad or stressed out. So I noticed that was my thing, celebratory eating. So then what do? You have to create a strategy to get around that, right? So let's say that you're a sad eater. So something happens in your life, you get sad, you get upset. It happens to all of us, right? So for most of us, that's when we want to turn to a really hot, creamy, fatty,
sugary,
sort of satisfying, satiating foods. Mm. Either they're foods that we remember from our childhood, like for example, I had cinnamon rolls, right? I loved baking cinnamon rolls with my grandma when I was a kid. So for me, if something is bothering me, that's sort of my go-to desire.
And most people have triggers.
They have a trigger, yes. And if you do that, if you just take note for a good 3 days, when do I eat? When do I eat? When do I eat? And just journal it down or type it in your iPhone or whatever, you'll notice. You'll see a pattern right away.
And why are we eating? Are
and
we
why?
Eating?
Yeah.
Is it recreational or is it because we want to heal ourselves?
Like, yes.
Why are we eating what we're eating at this moment?
Exactly.
That's probably a good question to ask.
Very good question. And it's going to cross over a little bit to our social conversation because a lot of people eat socially, right? Okay, well, I already had lunch, but Oksana called me and she wants to go hang out and it's 1:30. She hasn't eaten yet. I might just nibble on something with her because I'm being social.
Right.
So notice everything. Then once you have your triggers for why you eat, outside of breakfast, lunch, and dinner, right? Aside from the fact that you're actually hungry, what other things trigger you to eat and what foods you eat? The next thing that you do is create a strategy because those things aren't going to stop happening, right? You're not going to stop. I'm not going to stop finishing things that I'm proud of myself for and want to pat myself on the back.
Right.
So then it becomes a matter of make a list for yourself of what satisfies that same need. So if I want to pat myself on the back for my example that we talked about, I could make a list of things that I can do, from everything that is totally free, you know. I could call you on the phone and we could catch up about what's been going on, and to celebrate, you know, with some time talking to a girlfriend on the phone, getting caught up. That's free. It doesn't really cost me anything except some time. All the way down to, oh, I'm going to go buy that new dress that I've been wanting. I'm going to go get a massage. I'm going to get a yoga class. So you want a $0 amount to as inspiring as you want to get with your dollar amount, a list of strategic things that will give you that same feeling. Mm. Does that make sense? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, Exxon, if you're feeling sad, what's something that you could do for free that would make you happy other than eating?
I would blast some favorite music and dance my butt off.
Right?
That always brings me back.
Perfect.
Up.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's the kind of thing that you would want to put on your strategic list.
Okay.
And that way you always have a go-to food. So you'll notice yourself, oh, Larry was a little short with me this morning. I'm feeling a little sad. First of all, he would never do that because she's such a peach. But something happens, something makes you sad, right? And you're walking to the fridge and you notice, you just become aware. Wait a minute, I have a list of things I can do other than having something, you know, that might not be so good for me.
And in order to do that, I think it's important to go through and actually figure out what's causing these emotions that are making us eat something.
Exactly.
Or just monitoring, and once we monitor and see what it is that's triggering us to eat something, then we can actually apply something to counteract that.
Exactly. And probably put that list on your fridge.
Exactly, and put it on your fridge.
Yeah.
And I do a deep dive with my clients once they answer that question to go, okay, you know, I had one who is really interesting. Actually, there's Philip McCluskey, who's an amazing, amazing man. He used to be 400 pounds. Now he's this hot, svelte little Latin guy. And one of the things that he noticed when he was tracking this for himself was he just really loved his family. He just really loved those big Italian-style dinners where everyone sort of, you know, did a little smack-talking and a lot of joking and a lot of camaraderie and just real open love. Mm-hmm. And that's what he missed.
Yeah.
And so when he found other ways to connect around his family other than food and even coming prepared to family dinners with things that he knew would satisfy his hunger but still be in alignment with the lifestyle that he's chosen, bam-o, there we go. Yeah. So he still gets the connection that he wants, but he doesn't derail himself from his diet.
Yeah.
So once you have that, you can deep dive, take it as deep as you want to get and make sure you're truly satisfying the need.
Yeah.
But you're absolutely right.
So how long would you recommend someone go? Like, so the action step, the first action step is to go through a day and monitor your emotions and what you're eating.
Yes.
Right? How long would you suggest someone go? Is that a week? Is it a day? Is it a month?
Yes. If you can do it, but the minimum that I suggest is 3 days. And the reason one day just won't do it is because, you know, if you're on vacation that day and everything's hunky-dory, you're probably just going to get up and, you know, have your breakfast, lunch, and dinner and not even be bothered because you're mountain climbing and you're surfing and you're doing whatever else you're doing on vacation.
You're having a good day.
Exactly. You're having a good day. Yeah. But the truth of the matter is, stuff happens, right? So you want to make sure you're looking at enough of a span of time that you can get a real reflection. So a week would be amazing, but 3 days minimum.
Yeah. Yes. So go through the day and just monitor. When something comes up, like when you find yourself eating, I think a good question to ask, like, why am I eating? Yeah. Why am I eating? Is it because I'm hungry? Is it because I'm emotional? Like, what's going on?
Exactly.
Write it down so you can get back to it, look at it, and see if there's a pattern.
What about specific craving? Does that matter? Like, if you're craving something salty or sweet or anything like that?
Yes.
I mean, I guess that would help you to fix, you know, to come up with a protocol.
Exactly. That would be really good so that you can look for different recipe alternatives. Another key to not step over is to don't stop looking once you start eating. So in other words, let's say we all go out to dinner. We have a beautiful meal. It's completely satisfying. But then the waiter comes and he wants to know, do we want that dessert that's on special, right? And even though we're perfectly satiated and happy, we may be ordering just because we're like, ooh, like it's seasonal.
So
we might not get that again, right?
That never happens to you, right?
So then we're eating out of lack, right? Because it's like, well, it's seasonal. It's not going to be here next week. What if, you know? So you want to pay attention.
It's recreational.
It could be recreational. Yeah. It could be out of lack. So you want to track what you did, why you did it, and give a little insight there. The more information you get, the more you'll see, the more you'll learn about yourself. And really, you know, all monsters are just about shining the light and really looking at them. And once you do that, they're not really that mean. Right. Exactly. Exactly.
Yeah. What about social pressures? Because you go out.
Social pressures.
And then,
the worst.
Like for me, I love dessert. Right.
Yeah, okay.
But I won't typically order it, but it'll always end up in front of me.
Oh, so you eat what we call the calorie-free dessert, right? As long
as she
orders it doesn't have any calories if you eat it.
And that holds true, right? If someone else orders it,
I'm pretty sure
I'm good.
Exactly. So first of all, you want to make a space for social eating, right? Yeah. Because mm-hmm. we're human beings and we've celebrated through breaking bread. You know, it's a big religious term that you hear thrown around a lot, through celebratory eating, even, you know, romantic dinner. You guys have romantic dinners, right? Mm. So we do a lot of connection around food. And the last thing that you want to do is cut yourself off from that.
Yeah, no one wants to do that.
Yes, the moment you cut yourself off, you're suffering. And if you equate changes in your diet and your lifestyle to suffering, guess what's not going to last?
Right.
It's just not going to happen. So when it comes to social pressures for eating, you want to acknowledge everything on your plate. So again, this is a great time to get out your journal and write down what you experience in that 3 day to a week span, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. A lot of people get social pressures from their family, right? So me, with my mom's looking at the way that I eat, oh my gosh, no cheese, no meat, no bread, let me bake you something.
How are you alive?
Let me make you something. Yeah. You're going to die. Right. You're too skinny, you know, yeah. like... So you want to look at where those pressures are coming from, mm-hmm. and you want to make sure that you're acknowledging them, right? Mm-hmm. Because social pressures are really interesting. In the beginning, social pressure can be a pitfall to dieting. But as you stand your gun and you choose a path that really works for you, mm-hmm. and you go along that path and you start losing the weight and you start waking up with some pep in your step, mm-hmm. and you just start feeling good and your skin looks great and you feel amazing, your friends start to notice, mm-hmm. right? And the same people who were... sort of, you know,
doubting,
and they were, no, that's not going to work, yeah. And I, my friend did that, and no, that she just gained way more weight after, you know, mm. all that mm. sort of negative speak. Once yeah. you start becoming a beacon of health and being the example that you've been moving towards, now the social pressure is going to be the other way, and the social pressure is going to be, well, how did you make that recipe, yeah. and what are you doing, and what kind of juicer are you using, yeah. and how yeah. are you getting results, and who helped you, so... Yeah. Social pressure is one of those things that if you can just get up over the top of the mountain to the other side, it actually becomes a...
Then there is an applause. Yeah.
Exactly. Exactly.
As our friend Michael Bernoff yeah. says, it's not about like... It's about becoming the person that wouldn't eat that piece of cake or wouldn't go to McDonald's.
Exactly.
It's not about trying to avoid it, or it's just about evolving and becoming yeah. into that person that... just doesn't
it's
do
just
that.
Not you yes.
Yeah.
Anymore.
So it's not something that you're forced to think about and like, oh, I don't want to go there or do that and avoid it. It's just something that you're not. And I think that happens over time as
yes.
you add things and change habits and
yeah, and there's actually a biological reason why that happens, because if you've been inundating your palate with really high-powered sugars, high-powered fats, I mean, the fast food and, you know, most of the processed food is really flavor on steroids. It's like over-delivering to such a degree that when you actually get off of that boat, if you are around it, and that's another thing for social eating, you want to make sure that you have allowances, mm-hmm. right? So you eat the way that you eat, you have your lifestyle path that you're on, but you take Oksana out to somewhere really fancy schmancy and you know that the chef does killer desserts,
right.
you should order yeah, dessert. Yeah. It's yeah. a part of pleasure. Exactly. It's a part of life. You yeah. should factor that into your mm-hmm. to your social right. setting. So once you get off of it, yeah. once you get your flavor, your taste buds accustomed to real food flavors, mm-hmm. then when you go to somebody and they're eating McDonald's and you smell it, even if you have a bite, I guarantee you.
It's completely negative.
It will just not. Yes, yeah. exactly. It exactly. will not. You will taste the phoniness, the mm-hmm. falseness of that flavor immediately.
Yeah.
So you will.
Well, I think the point is you want to be satisfied. You want to do what feels
yes.
good to you.
Exactly.
But once you start changing and shifting things, then the things that normally felt good to you may not feel good to you anymore.
Exactly.
It just shifts.
Exactly.
So when that piece of pie or whatever comes that you normally would go for, you could go for it again because mm-hmm. it makes you feel good, but it might taste different. You might not.
Or you might not even yeah. have that much. Even if yeah. you have a bite or two, you're
yes.
like, yeah, you know what? Today it's a bite or two, and then in a week you're like, no, you know what? I don't really feel like
I'm
it.
Not
I don't want
it.
This anymore.
Yeah, right. exactly.
And instead, you crave like a healthy smoothie.
Yes, exactly. That's yeah. my goal. Mm-hmm. And but some things to know to get you through social eating, because they will come up, yeah. is come prepared. So if you know that your family is doing a fish fry and you absolutely don't want to do that, then you need to eat before, or you need to bring your own snacks and you need to mm-hmm. come prepared. Mm-hmm. The other thing you need to do is be prepared for negative commentary and be okay with it. So don't judge people who are judging you. Just make a space for it and know that what they're saying comes from love. Mm-hmm. They're worried yeah. about you. They're concerned right. about you, right? Mm-hmm. So just be prepared and open for everything that you're going to hear and experience, but don't let it change your course.
Right.
Just say, hey, you know what? Maybe you're right. I'm going to try this on. It's only 2 weeks, 3 weeks, whatever your adventure you're on. And I'll report back to you and I'll let you know exactly how it goes. You know, make a space for what they think too, and you'll be a lot happier. So don't resist it. Accept it in as love and then keep on your merry way.
And just say I'm good for now.
And I'm good for now. I'll let you know. I'll report back how it goes. Right. Yeah.
And willpower?
Willpower. That's a big one, right? I think of willpower as, you know, a really high-powered, uber-sexy, stylish friend, you know, someone who can get you in on the VIP list everywhere, and they know everyone, and it can make things happen really fast, right? But we all know that friends who can do that aren't always the people who are always there for us, you know? They might not be the people that we call if we're in dire straits, right? That's more what I call inspired choice. So when it comes to willpower, which will be there for you when you're centered and well cared for and you're really looking out for yourself, enough sleep, the right food, exercise, willpower is awesome. It totally kicks ass, right? Mm-hmm. When it won't be there is when you most need it.
Yeah.
Your self-care is off. When you're not getting enough sleep, when you're stressed at work, I guarantee you it will go missing one day.
And you need a backup plan. What's comfortable and what works for you, or the pattern that worked for you.
Exactly. Yeah. So I choose to rely instead on something that I call inspired choice. Because inspired choice is never going to judge you. It's never going to say you were wrong. If you screwed up, it's going to be, it's okay, baby. You know, it's kind of like your mom. It always takes you in no matter what, right? Now, in order to get to inspired choice, and inspired choice to me just means literally taking every opportunity in and making a choice. So the example of you loving dessert, okay, you've been doing amazing, you're looking great, your skin looks great, you're fit, everything's going awesome. You take her out to eat and you want to enjoy the dessert. It's something inspiring that the chef has put together. You're really into it. You are making an inspired choice to go ahead and enjoy that dessert and you feel awesome about it. No remorse, no regret, no nothing. You enjoy it through and through. In order to get to a place of inspired choice where you can say yes or no with no guilt. So in order to make an inspired choice, you have to be super clear on your big why. Then what happens is you equate the negative choice with the negative, your why not happening, and you equate the positive choice with your why happening. So let's take, for example, so your viewers, the Be Well Buzzers, can really get this. If you really want to do this, and this is a powerful... It's a powerful exercise to just do for yourself. It's a powerful gift to give yourself. Ask yourself why you're doing your health goal. So, for example, if you want to lose weight or you want to get a six-pack or whatever you're really shooting for right now to have before summer, ask yourself why you want that. Get really centered, honest, open. Just be as clear as you can about why you want it. Once you know why you want it, take a big deep breath. You might want to get a tissue.
And this would be, this would probably be a good place to pause and actually really get centered and think and feel about the why you want to achieve that goal. Think about the goal and then think about why you want to achieve it. So pause. We'll wait for you.
We'll be here. I promise. Okay. Then once you're clear about what you want, and why you want it. So you're crystal clear. I want to lose this many pounds, or I want this lose this many inches. I want this kind of six pack. I want my arms to be this big, whatever it is. You're crystal clear about what you want, and you're crystal clear about why you want it. Once you have that, I want you to take a deep, dark look down a really sad path. I want you to think of not only that you don't get it, but that your body deteriorates and you actually get the opposite of it. You don't get it. Instead of getting better, your condition or what you want gets worse or eludes you more.
The worst case scenario.
Yes, the worst case scenario. So I'll give you an example from my personal life because as you guys know, you've both met my son Maverick. So this did have a happy ending, but I was told no more babies for you. You're done. The hormones aren't right. You're just infertile. This is not going to happen for you. Right? That was what Western medicine was happy to tell me and just be done with that case. So my goal was get my body firing on all cylinders and have a baby, get knocked up, do this, right? I was recently married to Travis, who you guys know too, and was he not born to be a dad? He was, right? He's just perfect. He's so good at it. He loves being a dad. So when I got really clear on the goal, I want to have a child with my husband. That was my goal. I want to have a child with my husband. When I looked down the negative path, it looked really, really bad. That was like, you know, gosh, I really want to do this. I'm really fired up about this. I know it's time. I love this man so much. I know he's born to be a child. I would get the experience of parenting with him. So when I looked down that negative path, it was like, no baby, stress in the marriage. I thought maybe I should leave him because I want to give him the opportunity to go on and have a partnership in which he can really enjoy and feel that experience. And so even though my road to finding that love was so amazing and inspiring, I was looking at tossing it all out to better everybody and make that happen.
What pain, too. So, going down
it was just like, my body's failing me as a woman. I'm never going to, you know, my body's never functioning on all cylinders. If that's wrong with me, what else is wrong with me? Mm. If my feminine organs aren't working right, am I going to get cancer like my mom did and have a total hysterectomy? Like, when I look away from what my goal was and look at the opposite of achieving it, to be honest, it just came undone. I was a wreck. I felt awful. Mm. You know, the more I looked down that tunnel, the more I was just bawling like an idiot, you know? No. Then I take a deep breath again and just let it all clear out. Really shook it off for a minute and decided, okay, now I want to look the other way. What if I not only was in great, had my body firing on all cylinders, but got knocked up naturally, none of that timing, no hormone crap, no nothing, just total spontaneity back in our sex life, everything cool, knowing my body was a well-oiled machine and working properly, and envisioning us, you know, playing together and taking them to see the grandparents and all the joy and just sort of real ecstasy that comes with sharing that experience with your partner and watching a beautiful little life grow up. Mm. That was, you know, that was the complete opposite. That fired me up, you know, and that gave me the big why. So then when it came to, okay, my alarm goes off at 6 a.m. and it's time for me to get up and get on the rebounder and get the lymph moving and get my exercise started, it wasn't a matter of, do I want to stay warm and cozy in the bed or do I want to get up and jump on the rebounder? It was, do I want the pitfall, the horrible feeling of being in despair and sad and losing the love and connection I wanted?
Yeah.
Or do I celebrate this exciting thing, this exciting potential that I have?
And
then it's you don't even think about it anymore. You're out of bed before you can even answer the question.
Mm.
That's finding your big why.
Mm. What a powerful exercise.
Once you find that, everything is easy.
Yeah. And I hope you go through this exercise too. And like, once you find your why, take that path and go dark. And get the worst case scenario and like feel it, really feel it, and then come back and then go down the other path and reach that goal of success and really own how it feels in every cell of your body.
Write yourself a letter even, you know, write yourself a reminder, because you might have these moments of like doubt and, oh, maybe, I don't know, you know, it is, I want it, but it's so hard and whatever stuff can come up, it always does. So write yourself an encouraging letter.
Mm.
See yourself a month from now. How would it feel? And then whenever you have those moments, have again next to your fridge, next to your options.
Exactly.
Have it all there.
Yeah.
It's all very easy. It's very simple. It's just a matter of actually going and doing it and having it ready whenever you need it.
Right.
Exactly. Yep. And if you're visual, to take that a step further is write your goal in the middle of the page
and
put,
celebrate.
You know, like for me, I had, you know, like sad women, all this horrible stuff on one side. And then I had little pictures of cute babies and women with the schmancy stroller and, you know, dads throwing their baby up in the air. And, you know, I put that on the fridge and it's like, oh, what do I want to do?
Yeah.
You know,
whatever very works easy. For you.
Yeah, whatever works.
And it's probably best not to go it alone.
No. You know, partner or a buddy, you know, I take people through a 6-week version of this where, you know, I really kind of kick their ass into it and make sure that they're really taking time to get in the space in both the negative and the positive and help them every step of the way in creating the strategy. But at the very least, you need to open up and confide in the people around you and let them know what you're up to.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, so you've created a program, right?
Yes.
And I'm sure some people that might be listening might want to take advantage and have you help them go through this 6-week program. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah. So the program is called Rockin' Body Revolution, and the goal is to get to your health goal by June 15th.
Nice.
So we start on Monday, May 5th, And we hit the ground running with a one-hour coaching call, just one-on-one, me and you, so there's no wiggling around anything. There's no group conversations until this small group, till each and every one of us are very crystal clear on exactly what they want, exactly what it'll feel like to fail, and exactly what it'll feel like to win. Because for me, as someone empowering them through them, you know, empowering them through this process, if I can get attached to the positive of what they really want, like I'm up early, I'm staying up late, like I'm going to kick some butts until they get it. Because for me, it's like, you know, how I got so excited about the concept of having Maverick, like amplify that when you have a group of people who are one-on-one close to you, sharing that and letting you go through it. So we get crystal clear on what they want, and then we build strategies in place for every single barrier that we've talked about. So if we know they're on sugar cravings, then we're going to take a step-by-step process over that 6 weeks. We're going to feed the monster at first. We're still going to feed them sweets, but it's going to be all whole food sweets. So then getting somebody off crack is a lot easier once they're off a very dirty chemical version, right? So we're going to get them on real sweeteners, and then we're going to step it down until they're able to reduce the calorie intake that they're getting from their sweets. And eventually, by the time we get to the end, they're having a banana, and they're like, woo, it's great, it's creamy and sweet and yummy. So whatever their barriers are, we strip them down into bite-sized segments so that they can get through it. And of course, to make it very easy, because I know everybody's busy, I provide all the menu plans. And that includes the shopping list and the recipes and even videos. So if they're not one to cook, you know, I walk them through it.
And as your recipes are so amazing.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And we don't start from, you know, where I say they need to be. That's one of the things we do on the one-on-one call, is we start with the food they love. So if they say, I hate kale, they're not going to see kale salad on that first week menu. We're going to be subbing that out with a milder green, like a spinach or, you know, a romaine. So we start with what they love.
You're shortcutting people, really.
I'm shortcutting.
Because it took, I mean, we've been doing this for many years now, and it's just an interesting, and we've gotten into it and incorporated different things into our diet. And now we're at a point, you know, several years later, where people are coming to us and they're like, what are you doing? Yeah. Like, what's going on? And that's something we were talking about before, where people actually come to you now and like they start acting like you're the guru. And I'm like, I'm not a guru, but like, but it's just something that, you know, you start incorporating little by little, you start feeling better, your skin starts looking better, your weight comes off, you have a lot of energy. And
people do notice
they
that.
They do. Yeah. It's contagious. They want some of that. They want a piece of that.
Yeah. Especially when someone is not feeling well, and then they see someone. I mean, it's an instant connection. They're like, wait a minute. What's your secret? What are you doing? What you got?
So you'll be in time, and it seems like this is like a shortcut. Instead of, you know, several years of going through, learning, trial, error, Joy's going to help you get to the shortcut. In 6 weeks, you're going to form habits. You're going to be turning heads and helping the people around you in your circle get better as well. So what a gift to give yourself and the people around you.
Yeah, and that's when the tables have turned. All the people hassling you now will be the same people begging you
next
for that support and information.
Family. Family dinners turn into what do you think about this?
Exactly. Yep. So everything's done for them, and you know, they make exercise commitments that work with their lifestyle. Mm-hmm. But on the off chance they fall off the wagon, the same fitness trainers and yoga professionals that sculpt my body, I've done videos custom for this small group that I'm doing, that I'm getting to their goals by June 15th, and they're actually in our membership site. So even if you miss, there's no excuses. You know, you get the, you know, and that's the other thing, is because it is such a small group, you know, I give them my cell phone.
How many people?
We text each other. 25 people.
Okay.
It's a group of 25 people. So they all have my number. They text me. They email me. We have a membership site so we can kind of support each other. But if something hits the fan, you're not going to meet your the thing that you committed to, then we communicate with each other and let each other know what's going on. And then we give them a default, a fallback plan.
So
for example, we have a 15-minute rebounder routine. Okay, you get it. You couldn't go to the gym for an hour. You could do anything for 15 minutes. You can squeeze in 15 minutes before you go to bed. So we have backup plans, sort of safety nets for whatever's going on. We can make sure to accommodate them and support them through in a way that feels loving and helpful. So it doesn't have to be such a harsh experience.
That's beautiful. So if this is something that resonates with you, we'll put some information just below this video so you can sign up right away. There's probably less than 25 spots now, right?
Yeah.
So if this resonates with you, go get it right now. And just stick with us, and we'll continue giving you free tips and advice and take you through the journey of attaining your health goals.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, thank you. Thanks for having me.
With that, thank you. And thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time.